I would also like to thank Syracuse University and especially Julia for inviting me here. I'm very happy to participate in this event. I'm going to talk to you as a curator of three exhibitions that took place and still take place in Athens, about Athens. The first one was Made in Athens. It was the Greek participation in the Venice Biennale 2 years ago. The second one is Rethink Athens, which was the presentation of the results of a major international competition for the reconstruction of the city center. And the third one is an exhibition that will happen next spring in Athens, and Adhocracy Athens. It is going to present a wide array of do-it-yourself objects and bottom-up actions for the urban space of Athens and other contemporary cities. So I'm going to focus your attention in a city that has been in the international spotlight during the last 4 years, most times for the wrong reasons. And what I'm going to do is to show you many projects that are going to be divided in two categories. First, I'm going to show you projects which are run by the state and the real estate developers from the top down. And then I'm going to show you another set of projects which are produced by collectivities of architects, designers, and artists and grassroots movements from the bottom up. The presentation will happen in an old-fashioned Rem Koolhaas way, starting from the extra-large scale and finishing with the smaller projects. But first, I think it is important to tell you, to make a very brief introduction about what is Athens and what is happening now in Athens. I'm going to do this using three pairs of opposites. The first one is urban versus natural. And I'm going to start with the natural landscape that used to exist in Attica, which comprised mostly small creeks and dry vegetation. And this whole very beautiful landscape has been replaced by this new urban scape with flat roofs, solar panels and antennas. And the situation is, these pictures are taken from almost the same point, so you can see how the urban scape has replaced this very beautiful natural landscape. The second pair has to do with top-down versus bottom-up. What is very peculiar about the development of Athens is that the city has been produced from the bottom-up through the continuous repetition of a single housing unit that we call the Polykatikia. The Polykatikia has been produced in a vernacular-like way through the collaboration of small developers with small landowners in a very vernacular way, and so in a way that one polykatikia is made next to the other one, so that the whole city is produced in this way of repeating the same model. What the state has done, what the top-down approaches has done, the state has created a very flexible set of rules of building regulation, and it has also provided the infrastructure. But it is interesting to know that in most cases the infrastructure is constructed after the residential space is being created. The third pair has to do with private versus public. This is an example of a typical polykatikia. This is mostly a housing unit, but at the same time, it has certain commercial facilities at the ground floor and many services which are mixed with the residential spaces. So this mix of uses, public and private, inside the polykatikia creates this very vivid situation at the street, because everybody is in the street in order to either to go to home or to go shopping or to go to the services. Reusing Athens. Reuse is a very popular concept in Athens because Athens is a modern city. The greatest part of the city has been constructed in the 60s and the 70s. So most people have a mentality that everything new is good. The modern Athens has been constructed at the place of the neoclassical Athens of the 19th century. And it is very interesting to know that the most popular images in Athens are images like this one of the 1960s public space with the modern fountains, the neon lights and the traffic lights. This is the most emblematic, typical image of Athens that people feel very nostalgic about. The modern city and not the neoclassical city. As you may imagine, during the last years, the concept of reuse has taken another dimension. This is a very strong picture that shows people who are celebrating their wedding in a gas station, people that do not have anymore the ability to go to an expensive place and make this party. They're using, in a very autocratic way, the gas station to celebrate the new life that is starting. So, now I'm going to start the first set of projects. And I will start from a very controversial project which is designed by Norman Foster. This is a project about the regeneration of the former Athens airport. It's a huge area of 6 million square meters. And the program here includes high-profile residential housing, tourist facilities along the coast, a marina, and a public park between them. There is also a very high tower. They say that this is going to be the highest residential tower in the Mediterranean, and tourist facilities at the coastline. This is actually the most serious attempt to privatize a public property in Athens in order to repay the country's debt. This is a public. This used to be a public space, and now it is privatized in order to make money to revive the economy of the city. These are two very important projects that are taking place this time, in Athens, actually. This is a project for the regeneration of the coast of the city, and this is a project for the reconstruction of the city center. Phaleron, which is the coast of Athens, used to be the place where, when the development of the whole city in the 50s and the 60s took place, here they used to throw all the debris. So this is an artificial land that was useless until 50 years ago. And now the plan is to make a very big and ambitious public park with a lot of public facilities where you could have small pavilions inside the green spaces and the ability to walk along the coast line, something that does not take place in Athens at this moment. The city does not have a good connection with the sea. And this is the other important public space project. This is designed by Dutch architects called OCRA, Landscape Architects. They won a very important international competition for the regeneration of the whole Athens center. The idea is to create a series, to reconstruct, not create, a series of existing important boulevards through the creation of a new tram line and make a series of new important public spaces along across this tram line, like Omonia Square, who is the most popular and important square of the city and has been in a very troublesome situation for many years now. Now I'm going to another category. This is one of the most important modernist buildings of the 60s, designed by Takis Zenetos, probably the most influential modernist architect in Greece. This used to be a brewery plant, and it has a very personal of Zenetos modernist style with these linear windows. This building was half demolished in the 90s, and now, very recently, it has been reconstructed as the new Museum of Contemporary Art. The museum has not opened yet because of various political problems, but the main idea of the new design is that the building has two very different facades. One facade is a very precise reconstruction of Zeneto's initial drawing and modernist spirit, while the other facade, the main facade where the entrance is totally different because it is cladded with stone, a material very different from the modernist perception that Zeneto's used to have. Now, this is something else. This is a very ambitious plan to regenerate one of the central neighborhoods of Athens called KM, Keramikos and Metaxurgio, are those two letters. This is a very well developed project by a private developer that has paid a lot of attention to social issues and the architectural quality of the whole project. He has invited some very important internationally renowned architects like Atelier Bauwau or Bianca Ingels to propose new buildings in the area. And he has also invited many young architects and artists to collaborate in order to regenerate some of the typical existing polykatikias and office buildings in the area. At the same time, the same developer, it is very interesting to know that every couple of years he's organizing an art festival, something like a biennale, in this neighborhood, where the concept is to invite artists from all around the world to do art installations either in the typical modernist or classical buildings or to the empty vacant lots of the area. This is a very interesting art festival, actually, that is happening every September. Another example that is connected with another important Greek modernist architect, Konstantinos Doxiadis. Konstantinos Doxiadis was one of the most influential architects and urban planners in the Mediterranean in the 50s. He had many projects all around the world. And this was the place where his offices used to be. Obviously, the offices were designed by him. And a few years ago, a real estate company bought this office building in order to renovate it as a high-profile residential complex. There was a lot of controversy when they found out that this building was not listed. And the funny thing is that a very small non-governmental organization managed to list this building, but only for the structural frame, not for the use and not for the facades. So the new architects had to make their proposal for the residential scheme, keeping the existing structural frame, and this has produced some interesting results in the interiors, where this very innovative solution of the 50s has been kept in the creation of a new set of loft types of residential spaces inside the new building. So, at this point, I would like to raise some questions and express my concerns for all these top-down projects that I have shown you. The first thing has to do with the concept of environmental sustainability. Obviously, everybody is very happy about green architecture, and everybody understands that it is important to create such projects. But there is a serious concern that under the green agenda, there are serious consequences and problems which are well hidden. One of these has to do with the social sustainability of the city. Athens has been a very homogeneous city, and an important characteristic of Athens is that there is a very low level of social segregation in the city. Most of the social classes are mixed in the polykatikias. Usually the rich people live at the upper floors and the low incomes at the lower floors. And now we are facing a new reality where super high-profile new residential complex is going to be constructed in the most in the best place of the city. So the most probable scenario is that all this project, if it succeeds, it will be a new kind of gated community, something that it is far different from what Athens used to be up to now. Another important issue that has to do with attempts to regenerate the central neighborhoods of the city is the fear of gentrification. There have not been, up to now, serious examples of gentrification in Greece. However, people is very sensitive with this issue. And there was a lot of controversy when the first art festival took place here, and some of the immigrants that used to live in these buildings were kicked out. This is probably the only issue of gentrification in Athens, but I say again that people are very, very sensitive about that. Another issue is the economic sustainability. Most people do not believe that the state has the ability to keep such ambitious projects like these huge parks in work, in progress. And there was a huge shock a few weeks ago when it was announced that the European community, the European Commission, decided to cut the funding of both public space projects, both the regeneration of the Phaleron waterfront and the project for the reconstruction of the city center. And at this moment, nobody knows what will happen and what were exactly the reasons that the European Commission decided that. Another issue that has to do with economics is that most of these high-profile projects, residential projects that have been constructed, have remained empty because the local society at the moment does not have the ability to buy such expensive housing. Nobody's taking the risk to invest in new housing property. So most of them are empty. Nothing happens inside. And a last issue has to do with the concept of cultural sustainability, the way of the easiness that some brilliant designs of the 60s are transformed in a very different way that has nothing to do with the initial spirit. This modernist manifesto by Zenetos has been cladded with this stone that has nothing to tell in common with what Zenetos used to believe. So, I could have stopped here. This is an official academic presentation of what is happening in Athens. But I think that there is a second story, which to my point of view is more interesting, that I would like to tell you now. And this story has to do with how people have reacted to the recent economic crisis, a society that is in a state of shock of what has happened during the last 5-6 years. What has happened after December 2008, that was a very important moment, a symbolic moment, when this symbol of consumerism, the Christmas tree at the main square of Athens, caught fire. So the main symbol of consumerism was destroyed. And since then, the city has been transformed to something else. There are very serious new circumstances that take place, like the way that the poor population and the immigrant population is trying to survive under very difficult conditions. The fact that there is now a homeless population, there were no homeless people in Athens 8 years ago, and now the number of them increases all the time. And some very bad statistics. The rate of unemployment in Greece now is around 26%. It was much worse 1 year ago. It was almost 30. And the most terrible number is this one, the rate of unemployment of young Greek architects, which is around 70%. So this situation has made people realize that the perception that they used to have a few years ago does not exist anymore. The lifestyle that they had ordered is currently out of stock, and they have to find new ways to survive and to be creative in contemporary Athens. So now I'm going to show you a few examples that are trying to make interesting things from the bottom up, in some cases with no budget at all. Starting from this example here. This is a central space in Athens. This used to be a parking lot. Cars used to park here. And this was a place that was supposed to be a public park. For many years, the plan was to make a public park. But the park never happened. And one day, the municipality announced that a new development plan would take place here, creating office spaces and residential spaces. People became very angry. They couldn't believe that the last empty vacant lot in the center of the city would be built. So an open call by the citizens appeared one day in the streets of the city, inviting people to come to this space and have discussions about what could happen there. Some of the people that showed up were architects. Some of these people made some very quick sketches about the plan that this space could have. Some others made some first photorealistic concept diagrams or sections with some ideas about of how to make a border between the park and the traffic street. And after they took the decision of what should happen there, they brought their own tools and they started taking the asphalt, the hard pavement, out of the space themselves. Very soon they started planting trees. The state and the municipality had nothing to do with this project. They just accepted it. They didn't intervene. They let the citizens do what they thought they should do. But none of the state and the municipality had anything to say in the decisions that were taken. During the first months, this was a very interesting space. Many activities where all the neighborhood and young children participated. Now it is not so successful anymore because the whole area is in trouble. This is in Exarchia, an area that you may have listened, the most the bohemian neighborhood of Athens where most of the trouble takes place. But it may not be so successful anymore, but this is an important moment in the history of the city and the way that we discuss public space in Athens. This is a very different example. This is an architectural competition. This is the first prize for an architectural competition for the regeneration of a typical crossroad. The program had to do of how one could regenerate this typical crossroad between the polykatechias. This group of architects that won the competition decided not to propose a final master plan, but instead of a master plan, they proposed a toolbox. A toolbox of ideas that could happen very quickly, very cheaply, and in most cases by engaging the participation of citizens. One idea was, for example, to create a basketball playfield on the rooftop of an old house. I had the opportunity to collaborate with these architects at the Venice Biennale, where they produced this fantastic paper model. This was a huge model that represents in a very detailed way what could happen in this space, like ideas like the creation of a small garden where people could cultivate their food themselves, the creation of a small open cinema. It was very successful the way that this model represented both the vitality, the vivid atmosphere of their ideas inside the particular environment of the Athenian polykatechias. Another interesting project, this is a very recent one. This image is taken from a typical Athenian arcade. Athenian arcades have certain similarities with the Parisian arcades, the same concept. They are not so glamorous, of course, like the Parisian or the arcades in Milan, but there were spaces where many small stores used to work. Most of these stores closed during the recession and after very big malls were created at the outskirts of the city. So a group of young architects decided to organize an initiative to reuse these spaces. They contacted the owners of the spaces and they got the permission from the municipality. They made a very nice website and they made an open call for young creative people to come in this area and create their own workshops inside the arcade. They also had a fantastic idea. They contacted a group of light designers, Before Light is their name, to make this light installation at the arcade. And the idea of the light designers here was to find all the old shop signs, to reconstruct them, use new lighting inside, and put them in a different way in the arcade, so the whole space acquired a new identity, a new visual identity, by reusing the existing signs that they found there. Some of the groups that participate now at this space, these girls here, for example, are running a puppet theater. This guy here is repairing musical instruments. And many other ideas. It's a very diverse crowd of young people that are working there. And this has been a very big success. There are many workshops that take place, and people fill this space very often at an area that used to be deserted in the center of the city. The same group of lighting designers became famous a few years ago when they had this idea of a light installation where they invited many people, most of them were their friends, I suppose, to bring their own lighting devices from their houses and use them in order to make this public installation. This group provided the technical knowledge in order to take the domestic lighting fixtures and use them in public space. And this was a huge success. The lighting was very successful. And the way that this street was reused after this installation took place was very interesting. And this is one of the last projects. This is a project by Maria Papadimitriou. Maria Papadimitriou is one of the most important artists in Athens at this moment. Her work has to do with the immigrant population and some of the most difficult cases of immigrants, like the gypsies. What Maria did was to buy this very small piece of land in one of the worst places of Athens, called Eleonas. Eleonas is a no man's land. It's a place that nothing happens. It is an area between old industrial buildings and logistic facilities. And it is an area where only very poor immigrants, mostly gypsies, live. So Maria created this event space where people gather quite often for very specific events. And ad hoc exhibitions, sometimes by her own students who present their own projects of the university that she's teaching. And the main concept of this space had to do with food, with cooking. Maria herself is a very good cook. Pelin Tan, which is an art curator, also visits quite often the space and cooks herself. So the idea is that the artists, the curators, and many other people are cooking for the visitors, are the art crowd, but also the immigrants that live around in the area. And they organize some very fun events, like doing tours in the area by using the vehicles of the immigrant population and visiting during the events the rest of the neighborhood. This is something like an art installation, an art environment, an event space that in certain cases it acquires a sense of magic. It is a very interesting place. I don't know how many of you have seen films by Emir Kusturica, but there is an atmosphere, a Balkan atmosphere, that reminds a lot of Kusturica. So what I think it is interesting and why I'm showing you all these examples. I think that under these conditions of the austerity that Greece, and not only Greece, is facing, some interesting things take place. The first is that there is now a new ethics of urban architecture and artist practices that has left behind the consumerist ideology and the way of life that was associated with well-being. And is focused in more social issues and in the idea of bringing people together to do things together and create common spaces and a common ground together. There are also many interesting new strategies. These young architects here are working not like traditional architects, but mostly like moderators between the municipality, the owners of the buildings, and the crowd of the creative people that want to participate there. So this role of the architect as a mediator is very successful in the way that the space is being reused. There are also interesting strategies that has to do with design, like this toolbox, in this competition that I showed you, urban planning that does not look for the master plan, but it looks for a set of small, flexible ideas that could be used in different ways. And there is also a new aesthetics. There is an aesthetics that is mostly associated with the idea of do-it-yourself, an aesthetics that is not looking for the fine, detailed object, but is more associated with the imperfect, the incomplete, the thing that you can reuse from your own home, and you can bring it there and collaborate with a specific person that can give a new dimension to this object. So finally, I would like to finish with an extra small project that was designed in my office. This is an idea that has to do with an urban hut. It is associated with the idea of the cabin that was very popular in the 20th century, the idea of the cabin that is created in the landscape. Many interesting narratives like Wittgenstein's hut, Le Corbusier's cabin, or Heidegger's hut. The difference is that we decided to place this cabin not in a beautiful Greek landscape, but on the urban scape of Athens. This is a cabin where the user can go and have a very good visual perception of the city. This is a place where minimum facilities are included, a space that you can sleep, a space that you can read a book or write. And the general idea is that this is a moment that the development of the city has stopped. This is a moment that we can be detached from the city, go a few meters over the city, and look at it and think which are the potentials to make something new, to find new ways to reuse the existing building stock and imagine radical ways to live again in the Mediterranean city. Thank you very much.